And today, we are going to celebrate Jesus this morning. We're going to thank God for his goodness, his grace, his mercy, his love. We're going to hold on to the hem of his garments fresh and anew. We're trusting that God can make a way. We thank you that his word is a lamp unto our feet. His love fills our heart. And today, we gather in the name above all names. So this morning, may we speak to that flesh. Oh, we know that weary flesh that sometimes wants to get us tired and bogged down. But this morning we say, we worship you in spirit and truth today, Lord God. So rejoice, rejoice, for this is the day the Lord has made, and I will be glad in it. And as the psalmist said, everything that has breath, all that has breath, that's you and I this morning. You're a candidate. Praise the Lord. You've been elected this morning. If you're drawing breath today, this morning we want to let you know that you are called. God is coming. He's beckoning you today. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. For God is good. I know in this life there are many troubles, many things that we could be bogged down or have heaviness upon us, complaints and unknowns. But this morning we stand on the promises, the yes and the amens. We stand on the rock and the hope of Jesus Christ this morning. So today, church, we just tell you to arise with us. Arise not only in your flesh, but arise in your spirit. Awake, O church, awake. You can hear the call of God today. So again, we just want to welcome you that are here in person. Welcome our friends on Facebook, and we're glad you're here. In a moment, we're going to sing a song that's become very popular in the church circles. We're going to sing, "These Are the Days of Elijah." What a wonderful song. What a wonderful reminder. But just think about those words for a moment. These are the days of Elijah and Moses. These are the days that they walked through. These are the days God moved. These are the days that God showed up. These are the days that we celebrate, because these are the days of Elijah. But this morning I would say to you, God is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. And may we sing, these are the days of today, the days of Christian Assembly, the days of the Holy Spirit, the days of Jesus Christ, the days even in the midst of trouble, even in the midst of strife. Let us stand and say, our God can, because you know what? The days of Elijah was not perfect. The days of Moses was not perfect, but they held on to a perfect God. So now we celebrate those days, because we said God showed up in spite of. God made a way when no one else could. We celebrate that, and we sing of those days thousands of years later, and we say, Lord, give us those days again. And he said, I am. I'm here. The patriarchs, the matriarchs, the saints of old, they all had trouble. They all had fear and doubt and strife and pain and pestilence and war and disease, but they stood upon the promises of God. They stood and they trusted in the name of the Lord. They stood and they celebrated it. Today, church, we celebrate what we have, because even in our days, there's trouble and strife, pestilence and disease. But let it not be greater. Let it not be bigger. May it not be a shackle upon us this morning, but may we celebrate. So someday, if the Lord tarries, maybe there'll be a verse in this song. And that was the days of the church. The days of the church, when the church held on to Jesus Christ, when the church believed and the church walked in faith and not by sight. Oh, and we will say, just like you were then, just like you were with Elijah, and just like you were with Moses, you are still with your church today. Amen, church? Do you believe it this morning? So I'd say this morning, oh, flesh, you don't have a hold on us. Many of us are like the disciples in the garden. Oh, Lord, our spirit is willing. Our spirit is willing, but our flesh is weak. Stayed up last night too late, ate too much, talked too much, had to finish that email, had to watch the rest of that movie. We get to church, we go, oh, Lord, it's early. Church, if you can't this morning, we understand. But But if you can, I'm going to invite you to rise with us. Let's just give the Lord a clap offering today because he is worthy. Oh, Lord, you are worthy, oh God. Oh, praise him, praise him, praise him, for he is worthy to be praised this morning. You are worthy because you are greater and you are mighty, Lord God. We worship you and we thank you, Lord God. We thank you for sending your Son, and we thank you for the Son dying on the cross. We thank you for the blessing, the grace of Calvary, Lord God. And by faith, we know we are saved, we are delivered, made new, and set free today, Lord God. So draw your people closer unto you every day, Lord God. And Father, I pray that we will have a testimony of our days. That, Father, they'll look back and say, in the season of COVID, the church didn't let go. In the season of COVID, God didn't forsake. In the season of COVID, God was still on the throne. So, Father, for us that drink of the cup that never runs dry, eat the bread of life, stand on the promise, build our house on the rock, and confess the good news, may we proclaim and celebrate. May we proclaim and celebrate. Because no weapon form against me.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Oh, Lord God, your word said no weapon. Come on, church. Let it not just be a concept. Let it not just be a philosophy. Let it not just be something we've heard, but let us proclaim it. Let us trust it. No weapon. No weapon of the enemy. No weapon of man. No weapon of flesh, no weapon of the past, or no weapon formed against us can stand. Hallelujah. Because we stand upon the rock today. And Father, may we have in the days of COVID, our God is still on the throne. Our God was still delivering and setting free. Our God was still making new. God was still healing and blessing. God was still saving and setting the captives free. Oh, Lord God, we celebrate you, Lord God. And we worship you this morning. So I pray today, Lord God, the Spirit of God will flow freely on this place and we will know that we are standing on holy ground and that you will inhabit the praises of your people. So we take off the cloak of heaviness and we put on the cloak of praise this morning and we choose to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and we thank him this morning that he died for us to set us free, to make us new, that we are saved and delivered, set free in the name of Jesus. Oh, beloved, oh, church this morning, oh, brothers and sisters, friends, can we celebrate God today? Oh, for he is here. He is here. He's calling you this morning. Let him touch you. Let him fill you. Let him be the lifter of your head and the lover of your soul. Come to me. Come to me, the Lord says unto thee. Oh, Lord, we worship you. So let's celebrate, for these are the days of Elijah. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Lead us, team. Lead us, team.
Yeah. My my daughter and my new baby grandson and had a marvelous time. But before I went, I was giving God the struggle. For years, I struggled. My daughter and I have struggled in our relationship. She's a special needs child and doesn't always work right. We can't connect. We love each other dearly, but we can't connect so often. There is so much tension there. And before I left this time, I was like, God, I just want it right. I want to end your relationship with her. I want her to know you. We're struggling with that. She was raised in a Christian home. She knows all about God. She gave her life to God, but then she walked away. And so there's been a lot of prayer on my part. And this past visit, I prayed even more than usual. Pastor praying with me, and the whole way there I was praying, and I kept saying, God, it's your battle. You have to fight this battle for me because I can't make this happen. We fall back into old habits. We fight. We struggle. And this time, everything changed.
Hallelujah.
Everything changed. We sat and we talked. We talked about our relationship. We talked what we wanted from it. We talked about how God can work through it all.
Amen.
We talked and talked, and we never fought.
Amen.
Praise
and
God.
And before we left, before I left there, she said, Mom, you can't go. You can't go. And she didn't send me away from her house in tears and anger and pushing me out. Instead, she said, don't go, Mom. And I said, you can't cry. She said, I'm going to cry. I said, no, you can't cry. You can't cry. It's okay. We'll be together again. You can't. But God brought the victory.
Amen. God brought the victory.
And we need to declare those victories because they're all around us. We need to see them. We need to look for them. We need to acknowledge them. So I challenge you to look for the victories in your life. It could be a little victory. It could be as simple as I resisted that cookie that I wanted to eat. It could be huge. It could be God healed the cancer in my body. Whatever the victory is, acknowledge and give God the glory for it.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us have ears to hear. Sometimes we say, where are you, God? And he's right in front of us. Last week, Miss Paulette came up to this body and said, my numbers of my cancer is going in the right way. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank God for the doctor, but I believe that's prayer. Amen.
Amen.
I mean, what a victory. I mean, if you had cancer and somebody came to you and said, hey, your numbers are going the right way. Oh, amen. Okay, God, but no, I think I'd, amen. I think the family's weeping and rejoicing, believing for more, believing for that complete healing, amen.
Right.
And now we hear a mom. I can tell you, her story is about 90% of these moms in this church. You echo the story of many moms who have come to me and said the same thing in a different way. I just want to have a relationship. I want to have some peace. I want to have... So, Miss Chris, your story, every mom in this place can relate with in one way or another. Am I right, moms? Am I right, dads? So we're asking for God to move in certain ways. We're asking God to show up. We're asking God to heal cancer. We're asking God to give peace in a relationship. And guess what? God has answered our prayers.
Amen.
Oh, maybe we haven't seen blind eyes open yet. Maybe we haven't seen the dead risen yet. But we have seen God move in a way that's not just a flash, but it's deep. Stuff that gets written on the heart. So this morning, we're not done worshiping. But remember what God has done. Remember that we're going to see his victory. Remember we're going to see his victory. It's probably nothing we have imagined already. I imagine God's going to fight all my battles and beat up all the bad guys. God's going to do what he's going to do. For his glory. So this morning, let us continue to thank God as a body, Miss Chris, we love you. Thank you for being bold enough and sharing that. We love you and your daughter and your family and your new grandson. Thank you for sharing that. We just pray it grows deeper. Miss Paulette, thank you last week for sharing your story. Amen. Now, maybe you don't want to get up and share, but I bet you got a praise. Because you know, when you've been hungry and somebody feeds you, I don't know about you, but I like that. And when I'm thirsty and somebody gives me a drink, I start praising. And when I'm lonely and someone comes to visit me, oh, I'm sad. I'm happy. I'm not sad. So this morning, we all got to praise. And Lord, when did we do that to the least of these? When did we feed you? When did we come to you? When did we give you some? When you came to the least of these, you came to me. We got a celebration, church. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes. Oh, Lord, I thank you for the shout, Lord. I thank you for the celebration. But we thank you, Lord God. You're the same God in the valley and in the mountaintop. You're the same God in the tear and the praise, Lord. We thank you, God, that, Father, you show up.
Yes.
Because they worshiped you. Some worshiped you and some doubted. But you were still there, God. You were still there. You were still there.
Yes.
Father, may we celebrate Jesus Christ. So lead us, team. Lead us with a joy, with a praise, with a hope. Lead us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship Him.
Yes.
Let's worship.
And all I see is the battle. You see my victory.
See you. Praise you, God. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Lord, for 2 or 3 days, this man could not.
Thank you.
For weeks, he couldn't get off the couch.
Thank you, God.
Grabbed himself physically to the restroom, Lord God. Because it was so difficult.
Thank you.
But then you showed up.
Yes.
And then that. You showed up.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes. You made a way. God, you're good.
Yes.
You're good, you're good, you're good, Lord God.
Thank you, Lord.
Good. We're on the throne.
Yes.
You're the King, you're the Lord of Lords. You're in the center.
Yes.
You're in the center of it all.
Yes, you are.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're the center of our life, our heart, our will, and our desires, Lord. Be in the center of this church. Be in the center of my life. Be in the center of my marriage, Lord God. Be the first and the last. The Alpha and the Omega, be the King of Kings, be the great and mighty Counselor, Lord God. Be Emmanuel, because you are in the center of it all.
Jesus
at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus.
Oh, Father God, we pray that you give us the courage to make that our prayer. Humble us, Lord God, that we could stand on that promise. Father, can we truly say it's all about you? Forgive me, Father, because I know there's times where I've put other things in front. Other things I've seeked, longed for, desired. For peace and for hope and security. But Lord, those things have failed me. They've left me empty. They've left me broken and confused. Lord, it's all about you. It's in you where I find my strength. And it's you where I find my hope. And it's you where I love thy neighbor. And it's in you, Lord God, that I'm comforted. And it's in you, Lord God, that I'm strengthened. And it's in you, Lord God, that I am saved and delivered and set free. But Father, sometimes my eyes turn left to the right. And I seek and I desire the things of man. I pitch my tent towards Sodom. And I say it's better there. And I look for the world's security. I look for man's systems. I look to find peace where no peace can be found. And when I'm tired and weary, and I feel like I failed yet again, and I'm broken and I'm hungry, and I say, can you really take me back again? You remind me. You remind me of a love that was poured out upon me. Like the prodigal son, Lord, you remind me that you are waiting to put a cloak on my back and a ring on my finger and sandals on my feet. You remind me, Lord God, that even though I fail, that you forgive me 7 times 7, Lord. So, Lord, forgive me when my complaints get louder than my praise. Forgive me when my focus becomes less on you and more on me. Forgive me for when I make this Christianity less than, when I walk a walk that's full of hypocrisy, when my confession is not matching my choices. When I'm speaking from 2 sides of my mouth and my clay feet and my forked tongue, forgive me, oh God, forgive me. And Lord, I thank you for a God who forgiveth much. I thank you for a God who loved me yet when I was a sinner. I thank you for a God who sent his son to die on the cross. I thank you, Lord God, that the stone rolled out away. I thank you today that I am a new creation and I am set free. I thank you today for my salvation upon Calvary's cross, that it was not bought by me. I can't keep it, but it's a gift by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and no height, no depth can take this gift away. So Lord, call me closer to your side. Give me a biblical perspective. And may I truly confess, may I truly confess Jesus. Jesus in the center of my life. As the psalmist would say, as the prophet would say, for me and my house, for me and my house. Oh, come on, church, catch that this morning. As he would say, as he would claim, no matter what happens, no matter where the nation goes, no matter what they say in high places, no matter what they do in quiet spots, I'm going to confess for me and my house. We'll serve the Lord. So Jesus in the center of my life. Let's sing that chorus. Jesus in the center of my life.
Jesus be the center of my life.
Don't let your problems, don't let your fears be the center.
Jesus be the center.
Don't let the aches and pains, they're real, but don't let them be the center.
From beginning,
don't let the past,
to the end,
don't let the flesh, don't let the pride.
It's always
let Jesus, let Jesus, let Jesus be what?
Jesus.
Tell them, church.
Jesus, be the center of my life.
In all that I do.
From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for what you've already done in this place. We thank you for the testimonies that are ringing through the sanctuary. We thank you for the testimonies, how you showed up and made a way in the ringing through the testimonies. And Father, may it pierce our ears at a church. Because Father, if you will pour out that unto us, what much more will you do for your glory? So Father, we come to you this morning. We thank you and prepare our hearts to receive the word. Prepare us, Lord God, for such a time as this. Lord, bless us as we go forward. Lead this service, Lord God. May we not lag behind you or go ahead, for you are the center. So, Lord, have your way. Bless your people. Draw us closer to you. Father, challenge us, even to the point of saying amen and ouch, but touch us today. In Jesus' blessed name, and all God's children said, amen. Give the Lord a clap offering, church. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy this morning. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Are you ready to have some church today? Come on, is church in the air? Is God's here this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, encourage me at least. Tell me you feel it this morning. Amen. Anybody with me today? Praise the Lord. God is here. He's moving. We thank him for his grace. We thank him for his love. I just want to give you a quick announcement, and then we're going to get right into God's word. We got a busy day today, so put on your seatbelts, sit back, and let's get ready for God to do something powerful. Again, we want to thank everybody that's here, and we want to let you know, Facebook friends, God bless you. Thanks for tuning in. You're here in person. Thanks for being here. We want to welcome you, let you know how you can stay plugged in with us so we can stay plugged in with you. Go check us out at ChristianAssemblyOfSchuyler.com. ChristianAssemblyOfSchuyler.com. If you check us out there, you're going to find a couple things on our main page. First of all, you're going to find a place to leave a prayer request. We want to pray for you. Hear what I'm saying. We want to pray for you. You know what? You can go there. There's a place at Christian Assembly of Schuyler. If you go there, we're going to pray for you. Leave us your need. Let us know what's happening in your life so we can pray for you. It can be quiet. It can be public. Whatever you want going on, we want to pray for you. Also, we want to let you know there's a place to leave a gift, an offering, a blessing. We thank you for your tithe. Now, last week, our PayPal was down. Thank you, Miss Linda, for letting us know. We got all our tech people on it, so that definitely was not me. Let me say that again. We got our tech people on it, and they were able to, I believe, make sure it's working well now. So if you give through PayPal to our church, you can go to our website, ChristianAssemblyOfSchuyler.com. There at the bottom of our main page, you see a PayPal account. You can help us out that way. We believe it's up and running well. So praise the Lord. Also want to let you know that we want to thank everybody who gives and let you know a couple things. If you want to know more about me, you can go to my personal website at ForgivingTheNightmare.com. You can find out more about me at ForgivingTheNightmare.com. Praise the Lord. Monday nights, Wednesday nights, the last couple weeks, my wife has been filling in. I married up. Amen. You can say amen. Praise the Lord. I am blessed. You guys have had some great teaching last Monday and Wednesday, the last couple Mondays and Wednesdays. My wife has been doing both. What a blessing. You could tune in or be in person Monday night, 6:30, Wednesday night, 6:30. If you show up on Wednesday night, it's our family night. We have things for children, our girls ministry, our Royal Rangers, and our youth. A lot of great things happening on going on Wednesday nights. But Monday nights, it's primarily focused on mom issues, wife issues, women issues. But again, I know people are tuning in, so feel free to get plugged in Monday nights, 6:30, Wednesday night, 6:30. You can check us out on Facebook Live on both of those nights. Also want to let you know, thank everybody who's been helping. We had such a great night last night at the virtual Fine Arts Festival. Now, Fine Arts is a program through the Assembly of God where they have different categories that kids have a perform in or do a task in. Some have drum solos or poetry or sermons or skits or dance. There's all kinds of different categories. They go against a set of criterias, and last night they honored that with a virtual. All the kids came to the sanctuary. Did we pick up the food? Make sure, all right? There was some cupcakes happening in the sanctuary last night. All right, just being honest, okay? There was cupcakes happening in the sanctuary. Sorry, Marianne, I'm sorry. All right, but I told them I was going to blame Pastor Lita. No, praise the Lord. No. But we cleaned up. We cleaned up, but we had a great time. The kids were here. We were watching some virtual fine arts. It was a wonderful time just to gather together and see what God could do. So many talented kids. And I want to let you know that next month, they're having in-person, one-day event in-person, they're having the youth rally. Now, we weren't able to do it last year, the youth convention. It's usually two nights. It's usually a little different. But this year on let me see if I got the date right. On May 29th, our kids are going away for one day, and it's going to be all the mask wearing and 6 feet apart and everything proper. But we just want to let you know our kids are going out there. We've already reserved 6 spots. Pastor Lita got ahead of the game. She's already reserved 6 spots. So in a couple weeks, we just want to put this in your heart. It's $25 a kid, and we're going to ask you to help us out. We're going to ask you to, if you could pray about that. Maybe you say, hey, I want to send some kid, or I want to help send some kid. Maybe two people get together and say, hey, we both could send one. But we want to send, we got 6 spots. We want to send that all, and we just want to bless our kids. So prepare in your heart. A couple weeks after Mother's Day, we'll be taking a special offering. But just ask the Lord if you can help us out on that. Amen? Amen. And also want to let you know, next Sunday, you're going to be blessed. Let me tell you, next Sunday, put on your seatbelts, because we're going to have Reverend Bill Kirk, Assistant Superintendent of New York District here in New York, Assembly of God District. We're going to have him in our pulpit. He is a blessing. He's a preacher, a teacher, an author, and a hunter. And you know what? He hunts right in Cooperstown, right near Cooperstown and in Richfield Springs. That's his hunting grounds. So he said to me, I know your exit well. So he's going to come, I told him this time he comes, he's going to be a fisherman. Praise the Lord, you'll get that later. So praise the Lord, again, just a couple of quick announcements. Stay plugged in with us so we can stay plugged in with you. Monday nights, Wednesday nights, we thank God. Next week you're going to have Bill Kirk. And today after service, we're going to have our annual business meeting. And behind me, I believe some of the names are going up of who is who we may choose by God's leaning to serve the board. We're going to be electing 1 3-year term. So we have 7 candidates, I believe, for 1 3-year term. That's exciting. 7 people saying, yes, I'll serve the church. That's a healthy thing. Believe me, if we weren't healthy, you couldn't find anybody. They'd be like, no way, I don't want to do that. But we got 7 people in our body that says, yes, I'll serve the church. So praise the Lord. It's not a popularity contest. It's not a politician saying, oh, they'll represent me. We don't want somebody to go, well, they'll represent me. We want somebody to say they'll serve the Lord. Amen? So we'll ask you to pray. If you've been praying, these 7, we will vote 1 from this group to serve a 3-year term on the board. That's right after service today. I think that's about it. Tonight, 5 o'clock, youth group. Amen. It's going to be a wonderful time, and God is doing some great things. We're going to pray again for our nation. We're going to rejoice and continue to pray for Miss Paulette, Miss Gina, Brother Sam. And again, I want to let you know, Miss Cheryl called me a couple weeks ago. She reached out to me, and she said, you know, I want to thank this church because another victory. Her numbers, her treatments, her chemo has taken good root. She has a good victory. Yeah, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I think God's doing something. I think when we pray, God answers our... Wait a second. You know, we prayed that God would bring Gene back, and he did. We prayed that you'd have a great time, and he did. And we're praying for healings for our sister, and he has. And we prayed for Miss Cheryl, and he's done it. I think God is answering his prayers. Do you catch that this morning? So praise the Lord, and we're going to continue to pray for Miss Patty and her mom, and we're going to continue to pray for all the aches and pains. I know there's sniffles going around, not COVID, sniffles. You know why? Because it snows one day. I'm not exaggerating. Anybody on Facebook, we had snow, literally about an inch on the grass, and they said, well, it won't stick. And then the next day, it was 70. We have sniffles. It's not COVID. 30, 70 in the same week. It's a sign of the times, people. Come on. Praise the Lord. Let's go to prayer and ask the Lord to bless us, be with us, touch our nation, and bring that revival. Father God, we love you. And we thank you this morning for the sweet spirit of worship. We thank you, Lord God, for where you allow us to put our hands with youth ministry and in services, midweek services, Lord. We thank you for tonight's business meeting, Lord God. It may not just be a business meeting, but may it be a membership and family coming together, Lord God. And we pray you'll lead this, God, not to our will, but your will be done. Father, we thank you as we pray for those. We rejoice with those who rejoice with the testimonies that fill this air, Lord God, with Sister Cheryl and Brother Gene and Sister Christine and Miss Paulette, Lord God. These testimonies that you're showing up and you're making a way, God, and you're opening doors. We celebrate because your hand is moving. And Father, we thank you that we could trust you for even more. So Lord, we pray for a complete healing. We pray for fullness, Lord God. Father, may we not be people that see men like trees, but may we see clearly, Lord God, for you could touch us fresh and anew. So we continue to pray for Miss Paulette that, Father, that cancer will be gone in Jesus' name. For Brother Sam, Lord God, touch him, that cancer will be gone in Jesus' name, Lord. Oh, Lord God, for Miss Gina, that cancer will be gone in Jesus' name. Oh, Father God, we pray, Lord God, that you could touch Miss Cheryl and that cancer will be gone. We lift up Miss Patty, Lord God, and her family. We lift up all the sniffles and aches and pains of the day, Lord God. But Father, we celebrate you and we rejoice in your goodness. So, Father, I pray today you give us ears to hear. You give us a heart to receive, Lord God. And may our hands be about the plow and about our Father's business. Hide your servant behind the cross today and be glorified in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Are you ready to get into God's word this morning? Are you ready? You know, I knew we were going to have an exciting worship today. You know why I knew? Because the title of my sermon is simple, Sin. The title of my sermon is simple this morning. It's sin. One of the best prayer meetings I was ever in was in El Salvador. I was in a little place they call Las Delicias, which means the delicacy in Spanish, Las Delicias, the delicacy. And it's a mocking name because it's nothing like a delicacy. It's so poor and abuse. It's hard life. And they say it's where the women cry and the demons howl. And they titled this place called Las Delicias. And I was there in Las Delicias, and I was standing in a church. We had a prayer that we called, you know, those prayer lives, prayer. When you call, you are in the, how many been in those prayer meetings, right? You've been in the throne room. You saw them praising around the throne. You were in the throne room. You know, I was in one of those prayer meetings. God was speaking clearly. He was calling us. He was encouraging us. He was telling the team what we were going to do that week. People got mission calls in that prayer meeting. People got touched by the Holy Spirit. People wept. I mean, it was a power. We were on holy ground. One of the best prayer meetings I've ever been in. We took 28 people on that trip. 26 of them got sick. Sometimes you need that good prayer meeting to get you through some of those hard times. Amen. So I knew we were going to have some good praise today. When you title a sermon Sin, I say, God, we got to have some good praise. Because God's going to prepare us for what he has for us today. Sin is real. Sin is real. The wages of sin is? Let me say that. You guys knew that. I didn't have to tell you that. Wait a second. You already knew that. The wages of sin is? That's what sin does. Sin kills. There's no gray area sin. There's no good sin. There's no justifiable sin. There's no okay sin. Sin destroys and kills. Hey, that's a good place to say amen, unless you're in sin. If you're in sin, you're getting super convicted right now. You're like, I don't like that. I don't know what you're talking about. God understands. Sin has no place in the kingdom of God. God hates sin so much that he sent his son to deliver us from our... That's how much God deals with sin, how real sin is. Sin separates man from God. God cannot be where... Now, if you guys know all this, then why aren't you living? Oh, sorry, I'll talk about that later. Sin is real. It's ugly. We don't like talking about it. We don't like people rebuking people from it. We feel like we're judging one another. Well, but sin kills, sin destroys, sin lies, sin confuses. Sin keeps us away from God. And because of sin, we had a sacrifice. We had the law. And the law taught us to sacrifice. Sheep and goats and grains and birds and all kinds. Sacrifice all kinds of things. But then the ultimate sacrifice came. And this is where we say, amen. Amen. The ultimate sacrifice came. And he said in the garden, may thy will be done and not mine. And he drank the cup. He said, Lord, take this cup from me. Just think about this. Jesus said, Lord, take this cup from me. And guess what God did? He didn't take it. Jesus prayed, take this from me. God said, no. And the Lord said, I will drink that cup. To defeat what? To defeat sin. Praise the Lord! But I want to bring you to the very first sin this morning. The very first sin in the book of Genesis. Because Satan still lies the same way. And sin still reflects and responds the same way. Satan still lies the same way. And flesh responds the same way. Ever since the beginning, let me tell you this. Satan still lies the same exact way. He doesn't have a new lie. He still lied to us as he lied to Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam. He's still got the same lie. He's got the same game. He's got the same tricks. He's doing the same thing he's always done. You know why? Because we keep falling for it. He lies the same way. And flesh responds the same way every time. So let's get into it this morning. Genesis chapter 3, we're going to look at verses 1 through 10. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Now, I taught this a few weeks ago on a Wednesday night, so if you tuned in, you're going to get it again, but that's okay. But I want to give this to the body. Because sin does what? Sin kills. Sin destroys. The wages of sin is death. God cannot be where sin is. But we've been delivered. We've been set free. We're covered in the blood of the Lamb. And we're new creations in God. Amen? But sin is still about us. Sin is all around us. Satan still lies the same way. And flesh responds the same way. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 10 in the NIV. Now the serpent was more craftier than any other wild animal. Now the serpent was more craftier than any other wild animal the Lord God had made. The serpent was more craftier than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God lie one? Did God really say, lie one? Still doing it, isn't he? Did God really say you must not eat from the tree in the garden? Now, I want you to hear that. Lie one, he still does it. Lie one, God still, Satan's lying the same way. He shows up in your life and he says, does God really, does he really, does that really mean you have to forgive your neighbor? Does that really mean that? Lie one, still lying the same way. Does that really mean that? Now, he shows up and he begins to deceive. He begins to lie in a way that he's always and still lies. He shows up in your life and he challenges the authority of God. Satan challenges the authority of God. And with this question, that's what he's saying. Does God really mean what he says? He shows up in our life. He shows up in your life. He shows up today and says, does God really mean what he says? I'm asking you that today. I'm asking you, does God really mean what he says? Don't play with sin. Do not play with sin. Let's keep going on. Did he really say you must not eat from the tree in the garden? Then the woman said to the serpent, now let me just pause here and go on a little sidebar. She's not shocked talking to animals right now. I mean, if anything started to talk to me, if your family dog looked at you and said, hey, I'd be like, oh, Jesus' name, the only other time I think in the Bible we hear about an animal talking is when it's Balaam, right? You know what Balaam did when the donkey started to talk to him? He started to beat that thing. But here's Eve. She's talking, and they're like, oh, it's just another everyday thing. Like, oh, probably that must be so cool. Something we lost in the fall. But tell me, wouldn't it be cool to talk to a lion, giraffe, a sloth? Imagine the ants. Get out of here. No, I could go off forever. But let's just say, so we see that she's talking. She's had a conversation. And it's not, it seems like it's commonplace that she would speak to the animals. The woman would say to the serpent in verse 2, the woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden. But God did say, you must not eat from the tree in the middle of the garden. And you must not touch it, or you will die. See, let me just pause here for a second. First, Satan challenges her and says, did God say you can't have any of that? And she says, no, God said we can have almost all of that. God said, I can have everything but one thing. See, Satan shows up and says, did God really say you can't do any of that? No, I can do a lot of it. I'm free in Christ. I've been made new. But God wants to keep me away from sin. So Grandma Eve shows up and says, serpent, God didn't say I can't have anything in the garden. God didn't say I couldn't have any of those trees. He just said you can't have the tree that is in the middle of the garden, because if you touch it, you will surely die. Let me just read that again. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit from the trees in the garden, but God said, you must not eat the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will surely die. For you will not certain, this is Satan, you will not certainly die. Now she knows what God said. Does she know what God said? God told her what? That if you touch this tree, you're going to what? Going to die. So she knows God's word. She literally knows God's word. She knows God's command. She knows God's authority and she knows God's love. She knows and says, guess what? God said, if I eat or touch this, I will die. She knows what God said. And the wages of sin are what? So do you. You know what God said. But Satan shows up and he says, what? You, come on. You're not going to die. Wait a second. What did God say? What did God say? God said, you die. But Satan shows up and says, what? You're not going to die. Don't worry about that. That's, believe me. Now let's look at how Satan begins to lie. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows. For God knows. Now listen, who's telling who about God? The serpent, Satan, is starting to tell the child of God what God thinks. The serpent, Satan, is starting to tell the child of God what God thinks. And when you get your theology from someplace other than the Word, guess what? It's the serpent telling you what God thinks. She knows what God thinks. She repeated what God thinks. She said what God said. She knew the word of God, and it did not change. God said, if you touch it, you will. Is God a liar? Satan comes up and goes, listen. Come on, man. It's not like that. Listen, let me tell you. This is what Satan says. Let me tell you. You won't certainly die, the serpent said. Then he begins to tell her what God really means. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open. Oh, yeah? Yeah. You mean God's been pulling the wool over my eyes this whole time? Really? Yeah. You mean he gave me everything? He did, but that's... You want that other thing. You want the one thing you can't have. I do. But God said I'd die. You're not going to die. God knows
that if you eat this from it, if you eat from it, this is Satan talking.
God knows if you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. I'll be like God. This is the state of flesh since the fall. We've all desired to be gods to ourselves. We don't want authority. We don't want submission. You know what words we're promised when we go to heaven? What words we long for to hear when we enter those pearly gates and we walk across those crystal seas? What's the title that I long for? Well done, my good and faithful. That's what I long. But Satan says, listen, you're not a servant. You're going to be like God, man. You'll be in charge of everything. You'll be in charge of yourself. You'll be in charge of your ways. No one will tell you what to do. You'll be up in this house going, I am the man of this. Amen. You'll be in charge. You'll be like God. You will be God. Sounds pretty good. I'm in charge. Satan uses the same lies he used with Grandma Eve, he uses today. Sin keeps us away from God. Listen, it's only one night with her. It's only one night. You know, God's the God of forgiveness and grace. Listen, God knows my heart. He knows I'm trying, man. God cannot be where sin is, no matter how much you try to justify it. You know what? We can't justify. We go to God, and God helps us. God helps us. So he shows up and he says to the woman, first of all, God doesn't really mean that you're going to die. God doesn't really mean these things. He says, you can do whatever you want because you'll be like God. And when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasant to see, and it was desirable for gaining wisdom, what kind of wisdom was she going to get? Not all wisdom is good wisdom. She took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it too. Then their eyes were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed some fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Satan uses the same lies. What was his lies here? Does God really show up? First thing he said, does God really mean what he says? That's challenging the authority of God's word. That's challenging the logos. That's challenging. Is God's word real? Is God's word from Genesis to Revelation, is it still powerful as the day that was given to us? Is God's word still has authority? Does God's word still matter? Is it just suggestions, or is it God himself that gave us the word of God to speak to us, to guide us? Does God's word still trump Satan's lies? First lie, did God really mean it? Second lie, to distort what God said. God said to the woman, you'll die. You won't surely die. And the third lie is you'll be greater than yourself. You'll be greater than God. If you sin, oh, God understands. Yeah, you know how much he understands? He died and shed his blood for it. So Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam, they saw the fruit. They digged in. They took a big bite, and they disobeyed. They disobeyed. They sinned and rejected God. And the first thing sin did was cause that death that it was promised. As soon as they disobeyed God, God is not a liar. God will not be mocked. God's word is pure and true, because God said, if you eat of this, you will die. They didn't die immediately, but eventually death came to their door. And today you and I will experience death unless the rapture comes, amen? Because of the nature that Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam gave us. Oh, I'm not beating them up. I'm related to them. What's the first, second thing that sin did? They took the bite. They got all this knowledge. And the first thing they did was cover up. Sin always wants to be covered up. First thing they did, they looked at each other and said, we're naked, and they had to go sow some fig trees to get fig leaves to cover their nakedness. When we sin, we want to cover it up. We want to deflect. Talk about something else. Look at them, don't look at me. Well, you think you're so good? Hey, brother, I got to talk. Well, take the log out of your own eye before you take the twig from mine. We cover up. We cover up with excuses. We cover. You know what the best cover up is? You guys have mastered this. Us, we've mastered this. We have mastered this cover up. Are you ready? Anger. Oh, I'm so offended. I can't believe you said that. I'm so offended. That place, I can't believe. I'm so offended. Why are you offended? Well, because they recognize my sin. I'm so offended. That place is not showing me love because I have sinned. Oh, we've mastered the anger, right? We've mastered the eye roll. We've mastered the walk. The snap. I can't believe you're saying, you're wrong. Do you know? And then the next thing we've mastered is the argument. We start like the nuance of man and the creation. And we're like, listen, brother, you just sinned. That's it. What is sin? You know, but it's all smoke screens. It's all smoke screens because we're getting called out and we don't like it. We're getting called out by the Holy Spirit and we don't like it, so we throw up our smoke. I can't, that's not what my God says to me. Yes, it is. He said to Grandma Eve and Grandpa, if you sin, you will surely die. See, you know it. The wages of sin is God cannot be where sin. Just like Grandma Eve, you knew the rules. So the first thing sin does is make us cover up. Oh, we cover it up with anger. We cover up with booze. We cover it up with money. We cover it up with broken relationships. We cover it up with bad excuses. We cover it up with anything we could cover it up with. Amen? Because we want nobody looking at my sin. We don't want nobody pointing it out because it's ugly and it hurts. And I want my sin and you don't dare say anything to me. Don't dare. I dare you to. Because I'll be mad about you and I'll talk about you behind your back. We cover it up. We cover it up with booze. We're three bottles in with six packs gone. We cover it up. We cover it up in relationships, sleeping with it, whatever we want, he, she, them, all. Covering it up. Cover it up. That's the first thing sin did was cover. The second thing here, let's look at verse 8. And then man said to his wife, Then the man and his wife heard a sound of the Lord. He was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord. First thing we do is we cover up, and then we hide. We hide. Oh, we hide. We got our, you know, I'm not really into church because church is full of hypocrites, you know. It's not really my thing because, you know, I live a real life. I think nature and, you know, the universe is a God, but it's, you know, it's not. Like, the church is just full of hypocrites, and all they want is your money, man. And, you know, I'm more enlightened than that, and we're hiding. You know, I don't pray a lot. You know, you're hiding. You're hearing the voice. You're hearing the footsteps of God. And because of your sin and your coveting up, guess what? Flesh does what it does. It always covers up and it always hides. That's what it does. Hides. It may hide in plain sight. It may hide in intellect. It may hide in pride. It may hide in even false humility. But it's still hiding. It's still hiding. This is the result of sin. It always has been and it always will be. The same lies and the same results. And Satan's been using it since Grandma Eve. Is God's word real? Does God still have authority? You know what? God's going to make you like him. We cover up anger, pride, lust, lies, booze, drugs, women. But then, the next thing we do is we hide. That's what Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam did. They hid from the Lord. They hid from the Lord. Are we hiding from God? They hid from the Lord. Then man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God. He was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, "Where are you?" God is still calling to us. Praise the Lord. You want to know what his biggest trumpet ever was? Jesus. Jesus. From the moment that he called Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam in the garden, he's still been calling us. And he sent the biggest microphone. He sent the biggest message. He sent his son Jesus. And his son Jesus has been calling us, "Follow me. Follow me, follow me. If you've seen me, you have seen the Father. Whoever believeth in me shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. I am the door, I am the gate. No one cometh to the Father except coming to Jesus." He has been the voice. God has cried out, and he's still crying out today. So the Lord God called to man, "Where are you?" And he answered, "I heard you." The sinner heard God. Praise the Lord for that. The sinner heard God. The one who rejected God's authority, power, still could hear the voice of God. Thank you, Jesus. You and I are saved because we heard God calling to us. Even yet when we were sinners, even yet after we bit into that forbidden fruit, even yet we disobeyed God, we could still hear him calling to us, and we bowed our knee, and we confessed his name, and we believed in the grace of Calvary, and we walk by faith today. Amen? But today I'd say to you, he called him. I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid. Sin brings fear. It always has. It always has. I was afraid. So the three, four things that sin does, the first thing sin does is do what it said it would do. We're going to die. But I don't have to die the second death. Oh, I'm going to die. This flesh is going to be laid into a box someday. And that's going to happen. I do not hope for a long. Let me say that again. Long. I just got skinny. Come on. You know what I mean? Wouldn't it be a shame if I died now? I was fat for 50 years. I just got skinny. I'd be like, I'd go to heaven and be like, come on, God. Come on. I just got skinny. You're going to take me up. But there's going to be a day where they're going to put me in a box and some pastor's going to say, Mark did a good job, and they're all going to go back and eat potato salad, right? So death is going to come, but I don't have to die the second death. I don't have to die the death that separates me from a God who loves me. But the first thing, death, sin brought death. The second thing it does, we cover up. We cover up. Oh, some of our cover-ups are not that obvious, some of those things in our heart, but we cover up with humility or false humility. We cover up with pride. Or we cover up. There's a million things we cover up with. You could probably tell me yours, I'll tell you mine later, right? The second thing we do is we hide. We hide. Don't talk. You know, we got to don't talk. Don't. You don't go there. How many people have a place like, don't go, don't, no, I love you, but don't go there. And you know if you go there, I don't think there's a word for that, but everybody understood what I meant. There's a place that people say, don't go there, because if you go there, you know, you love each other, but you know you got a couple spots where you're like, honey, what? I love you. Don't go there. Don't. We're not going to deal with that today. Not today. When? When I'm ready. And usually you watch in the middle of the game. Then and then I'm ready. I love you just the way you are. Then and then and then. We all got those places that we cover up and we say, don't go there. And then we hide those places we don't know what to love us. And when our spouses see them, we go, you're still going to love me because I'm a mess and I got this stuff going on. And I don't even. But we hide and we think no one can see it. But guess what? The more we hide in those places, the more they're obvious to everybody else. The more we hide and we pretend no one sees, they're just screaming at everybody else. Are you angry? No! Are you sure? Yes! Why are you asking me if I'm angry? I don't know. Maybe because your eyes are popping out of your face. That's why. But we hide. We cover up. But even in those places, when we know that we know, and you don't need no preacher to convict you, you know that you know. Come on. You don't need no preacher, no church to tell you. You hear God going, come on, Jack. You don't need no preacher like me. You don't need no worship leader. You know that you're like, oh, man, I messed this one up. But even then, we can still hear God's voice calling us. That's a gift. Even then, when Adam and Eve, Grandpa Adam and Grandma Eve, even when they sinned, they still heard the voice. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you that you still call on us. Not to support what we did, but calling us to call us out of what we did. Amen? Not to be like, oh, I got you back, bro. Just keep it going on. Yeah, I don't know. God's going to be like, come here. I love you. Come here. Hello, McFly. Hello. And the last thing we do is we say, God, I'm afraid. And nothing good comes from fear. Fear is not from... Man, you know that part too, right? Fear is not of... This is what sin brought into the world. So this morning, I just wanted to give you these three things because Satan's still lying the same way. Same familiar lie. Did God really say that he's your Jehovah Jireh? Did God really say he's your Jehovah Nisi? Did God really say he's your Jehovah Shalom? Did God really say he's got you in the midst of a pandemic? Did God really say he's bigger, he's stronger, he's mightier than whoever sits in the White House? Amen? Did God really say that? Well, he did. Really? Really? God's lying to the church. He's lying to the brothers and sisters. Satan's been lying to us the same way since the beginning of time. Let us diminish the authority that comes in God's word. When we diminish the authority, we start becoming a cult. Let me say that again, and my senior saints should say amen. Amen. When we start diminishing the authority of God's word, we start becoming a cult, because then we can twist it to say anything we want. It's only a suggestion. It's what it means to me. How about you? There's a lot of, listen, there's one word. And that word makes the earth tremble. And it makes the demons flee. That word is authority and might and power. It's the sword in his mouth. And that's what Satan wants to undermine. Because once you undermine authority, you can do anything with it. When it's just a good suggestion, then we're already dying. That's what he does. And then when he says, you're going to be something, you're going to be something to die for. You're going to be like God. God never called us to be like him. He called us to be his servants, his children. First thing Satan says, listen, you could be like God. You could be like him, man. God knows that if you eat that, you're going to get good and evil. You're going to get the knowledge. And God knew he didn't want to give us that knowledge. Why? Because it's deadly. Because we use it for ourselves. It's like the little kid, right? You see him going underneath the cabinet. Oh, Mom, can I drink this? No, it's bleach. Why not? I want it because. And some of you want to go, go ahead, drink it. Go ahead. Go ahead. But you don't want to drink, you don't want to have the milk for 3 days and cleaning up everything. Come, yeah. But, you know, I'm going to drink this. I'm big enough to drink the poison. You can't tell me what to do. We have raised idiots. But some of us are like, Satan shows up, go ahead, drink the poison. It's going to taste good. It's going to taste good. It's going to taste real good. It's going to be sweet. Really? Yeah. Well, what about those crossbones? Don't worry about that. Don't worry about those crossbones. They mean party time. Let's have a cheer. Go. Oh, I'm sick. Oh, really? I didn't know. He lies the same way. He's been lying to you and me. He's been lying to us. And the flesh has the same results. We cover up. We hide. And we're afraid. We cover up. Sometimes we work at covering up. Sometimes it becomes our daily chore to cover up. Sometimes we cover up, it takes all our energy, all our might to cover up, hide, and be afraid. Oh, we don't know we're doing it. It's those mornings when we wake up. We wake up and we go, I got to build that wall up again. A couple bricks fell off. Oh, no. I'm almost a little vulnerable. Ooh, went to church Sunday. A couple bricks fell off my wall. Let me get some new fresh mortar. Oh, now I feel good. All right. Good. I love you. Just don't come too close. But today God is saying, tear down that wall and build me an altar. Tear down that wall. Tear down that wall. But God, last time it came this low, I got hurt. I know. It's going to come a little low. But God, now everybody can see me, God. I know. But God, if it gets any lower, God, if this wall that I've been behind so long gets any lower, I'm going to be afraid. I know. God, I can't do it. Forget it. I'm going to build it back up. I'm going to build it even higher. Boop, 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 boop. No, let's start again. Let's tear it down. God, it's getting scary. It's getting real scary. You mean I got to believe in you, God? Like, I'm not in control? Like, God, it's getting real scary. They're going to see me. They're going to know I'm a mess up, God. They're going to know I don't have it all together, God. They're going to know, Lord God, if my kids see me, like, oh, my Lord, my boy, oh, God. And then you know you got an altar. God says, you know what I want you to do on it? Lay on it. Lay on it. Oh God, I'll do anything for you. I will die for you, God. I'll go anywhere. I'll go to this land and that land. God, I'll sell the albums. I'll give anybody a ride. I'll do anything you say. Okay, then live for me. I don't want you to die for me. I want you to be a living sacrifice. Well, that's too hard. I'll write a check. How much? That's easy. I'll clean this. I'll serve there. Yeah, that's good, but that's kind of easy. Be a living sacrifice. Because that's what God's calling us, church. Satan will yell at you and say you're a fool. Satan will show up and go, you really believe that God stuff? You know, those hypocrites told you that. All they want is your money. But God will show up and say, walk with me. It's the cool of the day. And we can walk freely now. We can? Yeah. Because I died for you. Because I died for that attitude and I died for that action, and I know you're struggling and you're wrestling, but you're covered. You're covered in the grace. You're covered in the mercy because there's a new covenant and you're covered in that blessing. So come on. Let's walk together. God, I'm not perfect. God, I'm far from perfect. God, listen, I don't know if you want to walk with me. You don't want me around. You don't want to hang out with me. The other angels will leave you alone if you start hanging out with me. God, listen, I don't even know, like, God, I'm still wrestling through things, I still got, you know what happened, you know, I'm still mad at that, God, I was right, they were wrong, God, I know you told me that, but I can't, all right, I'm trying, but I can't, I know, it's too hard, it's only six, I know you told me to give 10, but I'm giving 5, huh? God, I'm not perfect. I don't have it all figured out. God, I don't even know, I've never read the book of Numbers, okay? God, I'm being honest. I never read the book of Numbers. Never read the book. Have you? Why'd you give us that book, God? What's a platypus? Why'd you put the tree there if you love? Okay, I'll ask later. I don't know. Just come walk with me. But I'm not perfect, God. I don't have it all figured out. I'm still angry. I still have it all figured out. I'm not perfect. I don't have it all. God, you don't understand. I'm still angry. I'm still hurt, God. I don't have it. God, I'm still afraid. Come walk with me. You don't have to walk a perfect life. Because of my son, you walk a forgiven life. So this morning, I'm going to ask Brother Dan to come play something soft and sweet for us, and we're going to close in prayer. Because I believe Satan's still lying to the church. COVID owns you, church. COVID owns you. Nah, 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 nah. You're never going to get over it. I'm going to give you 50 different strains of it. I'm going to give you this strain and that strain. And you're going to be trapped. I'll beat them with the COVID. Bum, 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 bum. Oh, the economics. Oh, the economics. You ain't going to make a dime the rest of your life. We're not even going to talk about politics. Satan's dancing. We look at Satan, we look at God, Satan, and we say, but God said, I'll be wise, I'll obey my authority. I'll wear the mask, I'll do what's called me, but I'm not going to live in fear. Because greater is he who is in me than who's in this world. Oh, I might lose my job, and that'll be sad, it'll be tough. Be hard, it'll be tough days. You're right, I will be concerned. I'm not going to mock that. But guess what? Come here. I want to tell you something. I don't know how. I might have to tighten the belt a little bit. I might not be able to eat T-bones anymore. I might have to go on Hamburger Helper for a while. But my God is my Jehovah Jireh. Well, I don't want to go through it. I don't have to turn in the car or not pay the bill. But if I do, I know my God is by Jehovah Jireh. So greater is he who is in me, Satan. And I know my God can provide for all my needs. Oh, and you know, people, what? There's a lot of strife and anger, hurt, pain, rejection. Political strife or putting people in classes and categories. You know what, Satan? My God told me to love my neighbor. My God told me to love my neighbor. Oh, he doesn't vote for the same person you do. I don't care. My God told me to vote for him. Oh, they don't go to the same church you go to. I don't care. God told me to love them. They don't even live. You know what? They live 180 degrees from your lifestyle. They mock you behind closed doors. They think you're a fool because you're a Christian. They think you're uneducated. They think you're the problem. I don't care because my God told me to love thy neighbor. I don't want to cover up anymore. I don't want to hide anymore. I don't want to be afraid anymore. And the cross of Jesus Christ. And Jesus would say, I am the light of the world. And in light, there is no darkness. Come to the light. Don't let the lies of Satan, the familiar lies, easy. We all slip into it. Remember, we're related. Don't let those easy lies consume you. But renew your mind. Stand on the word. Confess Christ. And may God bless you. So, church, God is good. Be aware of what Satan's doing. You got the enemy's game plan. See him coming a mile away. And when you stumble, God picks you back up. But he loves you. And even when you find yourself covered up, even when you find yourself hidden, even when the fear, no, he still calls to you. Come to me. Come to me. So will you rise with me, church? Father, we love you. We thank you that you are with us always. We thank you, Lord God, from the moment that Grandma Eve and Grandpa Adam sinned against you, you prepared to crush the head of the serpent. and you crushed his head on Golgotha. You crushed his head on Calvary. You crushed his head in the garden when Jesus said, "Your will." You crushed his head when Jesus stretched out his arms and they pierced him with those nails and they hung him from the cross. The one that would know no sin would die to justify, to make a way, to pay the ransom, to be the atonement for sin. And he would say on that cross, "It is finished." And in the Holy of Holies, at that moment, the veil that separated man from God, at that same moment, at that exact second, when God would confess, "And in your spirit I give you my life," when God would die and draw his last breath, at that moment the veil was ripped in two. Hallelujah. And no longer did we have to go to God covered in blood of sheep and goats. No longer did we have to only go on one day of the year. But now, what David could only long for, what David could only hope for, we, the church, because of Christ, have access. We have availability to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh Lord, may we not hide anymore. May we not cover up anymore. Oh Lord God, thank you for your spirit that convicts, that draws us closer to you. These altars will be open. If you need to come down and pray to God, celebrate, work some things out, that's okay. I'm going to be here. These altars are open. Father, I pray as we leave this place to step into some fellowship time before we come back to have a meeting. We ask you to be in the center of it all. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Give the Lord a clap offering. God bless Facebook. God bless you. Thank you, Facebook. These altars are open. If you want prayer, Pastor Leader and I will be happy to. We are having some food today. Feel as comfortable to eat as you want to. You know, it's back there. It's been made with clean hands. If you don't feel comfortable, you won't offend. But there's all kinds of snacks and drinks and things. So we'll take about an hour, 45 minutes, and have some food. And then we'll come back into the sanctuary for a business meeting. But these altars are open. Again, if you don't want to eat, we respect those decisions. But feel free to enjoy it. Amen. Lord bless our food. In Jesus' name.